I don't think I would be this obsessed or invested in the sport of football if I didn't have Asperger's.
Meet Alex Manners. As you can see, Alex is far from the average 26-year-old. He has Asperger's syndrome, a form of autism, which means the way that he sees the world is quite different to how you and I do. But rather than seeing his autism as a disability, Alex sees it only as an ability, almost like a superpower which has driven him on to do anything he sets his mind to. On top of his successful career as an autism campaigner and speaker, he's also a radio presenter, a voice actor, an author, and even a reality TV star. But if there's one thing to know about Alex, it's his football fanaticism. The proud supporter of four different clubs, he's visited over 400 grounds worldwide, his house is decorated with all manner of memorabilia, and any club chant that he doesn't know, quite frankly, isn't worth knowing. He really does literally eat and sleep it. I'm Josh Samuels, and Alex and I have been friends since our days presenting on Solihull Radio. In those 5 years, we've visited countless football grounds, been to dozens of matches, and talked non-stop football along the way. But even though we've spoken about his autism, I still don't fully understand it. I want to get to the heart of how having autism has made Alex the person and the football fan that he is today. I'll be speaking to the man himself, as well as to the people closest to him, about a life full of order, obsession, and orange. This is Alex's story. It's mid-July, which in football terms means an empty calendar. But for Alex Manners, however, every day is football day.
Would you say you're addicted to football?
I would very much say I'm addicted to football because it literally consumes my every thought and it's something that I indulge in every single day.
To what extent is that because of your autism?
I think my love of football and the fact that I'm so obsessed with it is definitely down to my autism. I think I'd still like football if I didn't have autism, but I don't think I would be this obsessed with it. Like, even this morning, I suddenly became obsessed with Millwall Football Club to the extent where, when I was working, I was listening to one of their songs, and then I actually went and changed my background photo on my phone to a Millwall badge, just because that's all I could think of at that particular time. And that's how obsessed, that's just an example of literally how obsessed I am with football. And although I would still like football, I think, if I didn't have autism, I don't think it would be to that extent.
In your view, what makes your football fanaticism different, be that better, worse, more intense or less intense, than someone that's not neurodiverse?
Well, for me, I can kind of, because I love football in general, I can kind of get enthusiastic and support and cheer for any club, whereas most fans would only really get fanatical or, you know, emotional about their own club that they support, whereas my love of football is, you know, yes, I do support four clubs, and they're the clubs that I like to win the most and I get the most sort of emotional about. But I can get involved and support any club. Doesn't matter where it is in the country or even the world. I can, you know, if I'm at a match, even if it's a club I've never been to before, I can still get involved and get emotional like if it was the club I've supported all my life. And also I think for me, it's, you know, when I collect things, I don't just want to collect like a few football badges. I want to collect a badge from every single club. So my interest in football is way more intense, I believe, than like the average football fan who isn't neurodiverse.
So, what actually is autism? The National Autistic Society describes it as a lifelong disability which affects how people communicate and interact with the world. In the UK alone, it estimates that 700,000 people are on the autism spectrum. Its causes aren't wholly known, though the Society states it is definitely nature over nurture, with scientific evidence pointing to genetics as a possibility. The biggest struggles faced by those with autism include problems with communication and language and difficulties understanding other people's emotions, a love of routine and a hatred of change, sensory issues which can range from feeling uncomfortable hugging to finding background noises such as the ticking of a clock unbearable, an obsessive personality, typically over one thing in particular, anxiety and other mental health issues, and meltdowns, which an autistic person can experience when any or all of the above just gets too much. This can take the form of a verbal or physical loss of control and can often be confused for a temper tantrum. This, in short, is Alex's life. As a 26-year-old, it's something he's just learned to live with. But as he grew from a baby to a toddler to a primary school pupil, these obstacles all made the world a very confusing and overwhelming place. It became obvious to him and those around him that something just wasn't right, but nobody could quite put their finger on what.
What was Alex like as a small child?
Well, I did notice some little quirky differences with him, which is what led us to get him diagnosed. So, for example, he couldn't stand itchy labels in the back of his shirts, and he used to have meltdowns and just a few things that I was a bit worried about.
And what was it that led you from that to thinking we need to get a diagnosis?
I think I had a word with one of the teachers or the special needs teachers at the school and told her some of these little quirky things, and she said, oh yes, it would be a good idea to get him diagnosed.
And how did Alex's life change when he then got that diagnosis? How were you able to better cope with that?
Well, we could then understand and maybe read up about exactly what Asperger's was and what it meant, and also we felt like we could ask for support at school. You know, he had a statement, and so we could work towards getting him the support he needed at school.
One of the biggest things that Alex needed help with at school was his uniform. Grey in colour, it was the daily source of great anxiety. As he now began to realise, his sheer hatred of wearing anything dark was another effect of his autism.
So for me, wearing dark colours, it just makes me feel like I'm not being my true self. Makes me feel like I'm almost not Alex Manners, like I'm hiding my personality, I'm hiding who I am. It's like almost I'm hiding behind a screen or a mask, and my brain just is in a terrible state of stress when I'm wearing dark coloured clothes. I almost don't want people to see me in them, so I'm going around thinking, oh God, who's looking at me, who's, you know, I'm almost in that sort of panic mode when I'm wearing dark coloured clothes, and that's completely different. I'm totally relaxed when I'm in colourful clothes.
And so it was colourful clothes that he turned to as a means of coping with the constant stresses of school, be they work or peer related. For Alex, the idea was to draw comfort from bringing his home life into lessons, and it worked a treat.
In PE lessons, I decided to, instead of wearing the school PE kit, which I hated, I decided to wear my own football kits, because I've got a lot of colourful kits, yellows, greens, blues, pinks, and the teachers, you know, were always telling me off for wearing these brightly coloured football kits into the lessons. So in the end, one of the teachers said, well, as long as you wear the school colours, then you can wear your own football kits from home. And because the school colours were blue and white, the school PE kit was blue and white, and one of the teams I support is Birmingham City, who are also in blue and white, I decided to wear my Birmingham kit into the lessons every week, and that made me a whole lot less stressed. And I think the teachers allowed me to do that, one, because they had more understanding than they would have done in my primary school. So they had a little bit of understanding around autism. And also, I think they just knew that I was never going to stop wearing my football kits. So they knew that they had to come to some sort of compromise. And I wasn't doing it to be naughty. It was just my way of, you know, coping with the school day.
It will come as no surprise to learn that Alex's wardrobe is now a rainbow of blazers, shirts and trousers. But it's his incredible football shirt collection, a colour-filled accumulation of handouts, giveaways and purchases, that I'm most interested in.
So this is it, the famous Alex Manners football shirt collection. Anyone can see the fact that you've got a shirt in every single colour. That's something you've obviously consciously done. Why?
I think, you know, so many clubs wear different shirts, and I always like brightly coloured shirts. So I'm always more, you know, enticed to multicoloured shirts. You know, bright yellow shirts, bright pink shirts, bright, you know, green shirts. So that's why I've got quite a lot of coloured shirts. And, you know, a lot of the clubs I support, like Swansea, for instance, wear white. So that's hence I've got quite a few white shirts. And Birmingham wear blue, hence I've got a few plainer coloured ones. But I tend to buy nowadays more of the more colourful ones.
I must ask, and this one's caught my eye particularly, this grey one here, this Liverpool shirt. Given how you don't like wearing greys, do you ever wear this one?
Well, I like to call it silver,
okay,
rather than grey, because I think that's technically the colour it was. But I used to wear it as a kid when I was younger. I don't tend to wear it much now because it's a little bit on the tight side, but I genuinely do like that shirt, especially if I'm wearing like brightly coloured shorts and socks with it.
I suppose what I'm getting at is you don't like wearing grey in general, and I can understand that. But I guess when it comes to a football shirt, your love of football overrides your dislike of grey.
Yeah, I mean, I also don't like the colour black, and I've only got about 2 black football shirts, which I must admit I never wear. I've only got 1 like full black shirt, a club in South Africa, and I don't even, well, I've worn it once or twice when I was younger, but I haven't worn it for years and years. So I would probably wear it around the house, but I'd never wear it out. Can I buy this hearing and programme, please?
Another of Alex's football-focused coping mechanisms is the matchday programme. Having bought one from virtually every match he's ever been to, the bookcase in his office is almost entirely filled with bags upon bags of them. But their primary function is a means of calming him down.
Because football has always been a thing that's always helped me to cope with some of the challenges I've had as a result of my autism and my Asperger's, and it's always given me another focus in life, I thought to myself, well, I'm like in my element at a football match, so how can I bring some of that enjoyment into other areas of my life? And football programmes are a great way for me to cope when I'm feeling stressed. So particularly when I was at school, and even now, I carry a football programme with me literally wherever I go, because as soon as I feel stressed, reading a football programme always takes me to a happier place and always decreases my stress levels and how stressed or upset or angry I'm feeling at that particular time. So reading a football programme is something that I've done for years to help me cope with some of the challenges or stresses that I may be or may have experienced. For me, it doesn't matter what football programme I'm reading, any football programme will help me to de-stress or to feel a lot happier. And, you know, when I was first getting into football, when I was about 10 years old, I remember my uncle took me and my granddad to watch my first ever Swansea match, and that programme was in my bag for months and months and months. And sometimes, because it was an away match, there were only about 4 pages on Swansea, and because they were my granddad's team and one of the clubs I came to support, when I was feeling stressed, I wouldn't just get the programme out and read the whole programme, I would literally just read the 4 Swansea pages. So it doesn't really matter whether I've read the programme 10, 20, 30, 40 times, or whether it's a completely brand new one that I've never read. Just the fact that it's a football programme will be sufficient enough to de-stress me.
Although Alex now supports Birmingham, Burton, Solihull and Swansea, his first love in football was actually Manchester United, taking on the tradition of supporting his dad's team. However, it has instead been his dad's best friend Tim that has ended up providing the greatest inspiration for Alex's football mania. In fact, it was Tim that took a 10-year-old Alex to his first ever game.
He'd had this love of footballs and stuff, and I always used to take him footballs, we'd play at the park, and I said to him one time, I said, I'll take you to a match if you want to, and he was kind of really excited about that. So I think a bit of time passed, and then I said, look, do you fancy going to a midweek game at Birmingham, because that's my team? So he was quite excited, and can't remember much about the game, but I know he was super excited and he kind of loved it, and I think that was the start of his passion for football, and that's where it all began, yeah.
QPR versus Birmingham. So see, the ground behind me, Loftus Road, has been QPR's second home since their induction into the Football League.
For Alex, it was love at first sight. Over the next decade, he and Tim would embark on the mammoth task of completing the 92. In other words, watching a match at every ground in England's top 4 divisions, something which the travelling twosome finally accomplished in 2018.
Come on, you Brewers.
When I was younger, and we'd probably been to about 20 or 30 grounds at this point, Tim said that, you know, a lot of fans try and make it their lifetime goal to watch a match at all 92 football grounds. And as soon as he said this to me, it was like a light bulb in my head going off, thinking, oh wow, I'd absolutely love to do that. And it was then that I decided that I wanted desperately to watch a match at all 92 football grounds.
I didn't quite expect to be the one to facilitate that throughout, but I think from my perspective, I thought, you know, it would be something memorable and nice to do that for him. You know, we always had a very close bond, and I know he was super excited, and it was a real release for him with other things going on in his life that he had the football to look forward to. So I think the football grounds just became days out for us, visiting different towns, cities, just having fun together, ticking off different grounds for him. And in no time at all, we were getting close to that 92 point.
Including those he's watched a match at, Alex estimates that he's visited over 400 grounds worldwide. But it's not just professional clubs that he enjoys visiting. In fact, he says that he gets just as much, if not more pleasure, out of visiting non-league outfits too. So we took a trip to Hertfordshire to visit Clarence Park, home of St Albans City, a semi-professional club currently plying its trade in England's sixth tier, and one that Alex was desperate to see. Alongside a personal stadium tour, Alex also got the chance to walk out of the tunnel, just as if he were one of the players. Unfortunately for him, a trial with the Saints might just be off the cards, but that didn't stop him from enjoying his surroundings.
What's your feeling standing on the pitch?
Amazing. That's the only word I can describe it as. People don't understand my level of passion and interest in football, but like just being on a pitch, and I mean, most people would say it's just grass, but look what's around you. It's an amazing stadium. For me, you don't get grounds built like this. You can see the history of this ground. You can feel like the fans coming from the local area to support the club. I mean, for me, coming here is just as good as going to Old Trafford or Wembley, if not more exciting.
From this evening, I must give the British people a very simple instruction. You must stay at home.
The 23rd of March 2020, the day that Prime Minister Boris Johnson announced that the UK was going into a nationwide lockdown in the fight against COVID-19. It marked the beginning of weeks and months of complete terror for many across the country, and especially for Alex. The great disruptions to the order and routine that he was used to, already heightened by his autism, were further worsened when football was brought to a complete standstill.
Good afternoon and welcome to Sky Sports News. The Premier League, Football League and Women's Super League is suspended until April the 3rd due to coronavirus.
The one thing that gives him the greatest pleasure in the whole world, and as we've already heard, has been such a release for him throughout his life, gone just like that. And if that wasn't bad enough, he also faced the daunting prospect of having to leave his hometown after his parents relocated to Broadway in the Cotswolds. Luckily, he was able to remain in Solihull when his grandparents invited him to move in, but that didn't make the overwhelming effects of lockdown any easier.
I thought he coped pretty well, but I think more recently he's said, we didn't notice particularly, but he has said that he struggled quite a lot with his, worried about the lockdown and the limitations that are placed on him, because he's a very social animal, as you know.
However, even during the dark of a worldwide pandemic, it was football that ended up once again bringing the light that Alex so desperately needed. Ironically, it would be Charles Wickham Road, home of Broadway United, the club of the village that Alex refused to move to, that he would find the greatest solace during those times of restrictions.
This is a football ground that I'd been walking past and had been past loads and loads of times before the lockdown, because my parents only live over the road from it. So it was a familiar place for me to come to when I couldn't go to any other matches or any other grounds. So it was a really great place to come to during the lockdowns.
Describe how it made you feel.
When I was coming to this particular ground during the lockdowns, it made me feel like I was indulging in my passion and my love of football, even though I wasn't able to go to matches or to any other stadiums like I normally would do every week. It still gave me a sense of, you know, doing something familiar and doing something that I still enjoyed. And being in a football stadium, no matter whether that's a really small ground like this or a massive 60,000 capacity Premier League stadium, I still get that buzz of being in a football stadium.
I have to ask, I don't want to offend you, but it's a bit of a state. Why do you still feel such an affinity with it?
I think because my parents live in the village, and this is a local football club, and this is like the only football stand in the village where my parents live, and because, again, you know, it's a familiar location to me where I come all the time, so I feel very much at home when I'm here. But yeah, being in this stand, however old and shabby it looks, I can't describe what an amazing feeling it is.
Can you try and describe it?
It feels like I'm almost totally relaxed. I mean, I could literally stand here for 2-3 hours just looking onto the grass pitch or just looking at the stand. It gives me such a warm, happy feeling being in the stand.
When you look out onto it, what thoughts go through your mind?
All I'm thinking about is, when I'm looking at the pitch, is if Broadway United were to have a non-league club, I'm sort of thinking to myself, oh, what could they do if they, you know, climbed up the pyramid of non-league? You know, I'm thinking about where the stands could be built and how many fans they could fit into the ground and where the club shop could be located. So when I'm at a ground like this, I'm always thinking about how they could develop it if the club, like, progressed up the pyramid.
So, after following Alex pretty closely over the course of the last month, what is it that I've actually learned? Well, his sheer love for football now makes a whole lot more sense. It seems inevitable that something that you constantly use for support as a child is going to continue to provide so much comfort during adulthood. And just having that crutch of a program or buying the badge from the latest match you've been to. I've seen with my own eyes how happy his world is with football in it. Hence why he's the only person, possibly on the planet, who will happily while away his time eating lunch in the middle of the Pershore Town main stand. But on a personal level, I feel like I understand his story and his journey a lot better now too. How he's channeled the misery of primary school into a multifaceted and fully independent life. One that is colourful in every sense of the word. And I think that's what the moral of this story, if there is one, should be. No matter how dark your start in life might seem, just know that there is always a rainbow above your head.
The sky is finally opened, the rain and wind stop blowing, but you're stuck at...
Well, as a thank you for taking part in this documentary, I've just got a few little things that you can add to your football
thank
collection.
You.
Let go of your umbrella, cause darling, I'm just trying to tell.
Oh my God, it's Bilson Town.
There's always been a rainbow.
Oh my God, Thornton.
In a rainbow hanging over.
And are these signed, so that's, they're signed by the players on the front?
Yeah.
Oh wow.
It'll all be alright.
Oh my God, it's Linton FC, oh my God.